brief edition of Reasonable Faith. And basically, let me just catch up to speed, then we'll listen to the last part of it. Craig lives in Georgia, teaches out at Talbot. Was out doing a class, so you know he's out there for a short period of time, intensive class, then he goes back to Georgia, basically is how it works. And so he said he was looking for a place to go to church. I guess he doesn't have a regular place that he attends when he's in Talbot, which is weird. At least that's what the language suggested to me. Anyhow, listen to a sermon by some fella. The transcript is on Reasonable Faith website if you want to see who it was, who gave a sermon on a mistaken view of love. And so they're talking about how we should love God and our love should be passionate, not just out of obedience. Now, what they're talking about is that to correct the secular misapprehension of love, many Christian pastors have had to point out that we are commanded to love God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's a command. You can't command your emotions. So there is a true element of the fact that biblical love is a commitment, it is an act of obedience, it is a decision. When you say you're going to love your wife for your entire life, it is not. I am going to have the same emotional feeling for her every single day, every single moment. Our emotions wax and wane, but our commitment, and it can be a passionate commitment, but not merely a passion, will abide throughout our lives. And so there's been a necessary correction to the worldly idea that love is an emotion, and therefore you no longer feel the emotion, you're no longer in love, therefore you don't have to be married any longer, therefore just, you know, get a divorce, and that's the end of that. So biblically, true biblical love, I believe, starts with that recognition of its biblical definition and then becomes deeper as the proper passion is associated with it. Well, they're talking about that, and I'm playing it a little bit faster. Here's what he had to say.
The other person, to be connected with that other person emotionally. God has genuine affection for us, and therefore, if we think of love merely as a decision and not a feeling, we're apt to mischaracterize God's love for us, and in turn, that will make it, I think, very difficult to respond to God's love if you think God really doesn't like you, doesn't really have any affection for you. And it occurred to me at the time as I was listening, Kevin, that it may also be the case that not only do some Christians look at God that way, he may also have that kind of affectionless love for God. They give God his due, but they don't really like God. They'll worship him, they'll do the things that they're obligated to do, but they don't really like God.
Now, I just stop for just a moment. Again, not trying to, people, I just don't understand what you've got against William Lane Craig. It's, I don't know how many times I have to say it, apologetics flows from theology. Theology matters. I think Bill Craig has a really deficient theology, and so the people who are interested in this program are also interested in what he does, and they see the differences. And so we end up probably talking about the differences more than we would with almost anybody else because we're debating many of the same people. We're in the same arena. We're just giving very different answers because we have very different theology. And in this instance, my concern is that as a person who has done loss support counseling, deals with people who are dealing with tremendous trials in their life, a child with a disease that is going to take them before their second birthday or something like that. There can be times when, in all honesty, we have to bow before the sovereignty of God and we must obey his command to love him. But that particular point in time, we're very confused about the nature of the passion that we have. And if we don't recognize that's the reality, then I don't think we're really recognizing how God has made us. And the people who seem to love God with the most abiding, firm passion over time are those who've walked with him through the valley of the shadow of death, where they themselves have been most greatly hurt, and in their hurt have come to understand the love of God in a way that no mere description of love as passion ever could. So I hear what he's saying, but I want to keep that in mind.
And that's really frightening. And I've talked to some people who are Christians, I think, who labor under that problem. They don't really like God.
Now, I think I've listened to William Lane Craig enough to know that right now he is arguing with himself as to whether he's going to mention Calvinists, because that's who he's talking about. And remember, when he was asked in a debate about false teachers in the Christian church, who was the only people he could come up with? Calvinists. Couldn't come up with the Mormons, couldn't come up with the Jehovah's Witnesses, couldn't come up with the papacy. Came up with Calvinists. When Christopher Hitchens debated him at Biola. So, you know, when people say, oh, you're just focused on him. Well, why is he focused on the Calvinists? You know, I mean, we could turn this around. I just think he recognizes how different we are because of our theologies. But I can tell by the stutter there. He's arguing with himself. Do I go there? Well, the other guys can make him go there.
But they dutifully do their obligations. And so this was really a thought-provoking sermon for me, and I think
he's right.
And why
wouldn't they, Bill? Why wouldn't they like God?
Well, I almost hate to say it, but some people that I've talked to who come out of the Calvinistic and Reformed tradition...
You just had to go there, didn't you?
I know, sorry.
Go ahead.
Because that's Dr. Tana's tradition as well.
Okay.
But honestly, I've talked to people who come out of that tradition who I think deep down inside really harbor a kind of dislike of God because of his predestinarian, all-controlling activity. He's the one that's responsible for sending their loved ones to hell because that's the way he's chosen to do it. And you just give God his glory because it's due to him. Give God glory, but you don't really like a person such as God is described in that sort of theology.
As someone on Twitter, it may have been even the person who pointed me to this on Twitter, said, oh yeah, that objection could never be raised against Molinism. Well, of course, it most definitely can be. Because Molinism has God micromanaging every single event in time so as to put these free creatures that he knows will do X because of middle knowledge into the circumstances where they'll do X. So how can that not be? I mean, the only way that the Molinists can get around that is by saying, well, I just never thought it through before. But you have an extensive divine decree in Molinism. It's just limited by his middle knowledge, of course, to the world that he's decided to create, given the cards he was dealt and all that kind of stuff. But the point is that this kind of an objection could be, I think, much more meaningfully raised against the Molinist God and the Molinist tradition. Because you can't say that there is a purpose in any of the evil that we might experience, including the death of loved ones. That just happens to be the way it was in the best of all possible worlds. It's just the best we could do. Yes?
I just don't understand why it is that we're the ones that have to explain the need for redemption. The Arminians believe that there is a need for redemption. We believe there's a need for redemption. Mankind is fallen, but somehow that's on the Calvinist's shoulders to burden, and somehow the Arminian doesn't have to explain this. It's all our fault because, well, this is the way God created everything.
His answer would be that from his perspective, since God has left it up to man's free will, then God has done his best to save each person. That's why he does the amazing mind tricks in Molinism of going, well, you know, God could have actuated a world where everyone who does not hear the gospel would not have responded positively to the gospel in the first place. So, see, he's saying that God's done everything he can, and he's actually saving the maximum number of people possible. He's saving everybody who would believe, but there are people who would never believe, and they're the ones who are actually lost. And so you are getting to have all of your cake and eat all of it too. You get free will, and you get a God who tries to save everybody, and you get salvation of everyone who could possibly be saved. Isn't it wonderful? Isn't that Molinism? Now, it doesn't make a lick of sense. It's about as biblical as Mormonism is, but you got it all.
And how is it that this God could not find it in his perfect self, his immutable self, his immense self, that he couldn't actuate a world where Adam didn't fall? And there was no fall. No, we can't go there. That's not allowed.
Well, you see, if Adam doesn't fall, then that changes the content of middle knowledge, and
this is our problem.
I'm sure some of our middle knowledge advocates who write to you after every time I talk about middle knowledge will explain to you why God didn't.
And
do that.
I'm sure there won't be a lick of Bible in any of it, as usual.
Well, thank you for letting us know exactly what you think about that, Rich. Yeah, so anyway.
Yeah, I know it's anecdotal, and I've talked to at least two people who just became very depressed, very devoted to God and everything, very Calvinistic in their tradition, but it just really depressed them.
Yeah.
And so on. Now, I know...
So, depressed Calvinists are an argument here. You look like a tired Calvinist, are you?
I'm a tired Calvinist. I'm not particularly depressed. I'm happy to be here.
Happy to be here. Okay, good.
And not still in DIA.
Yes, that's Denver International Airport for those who are, because that sounds very much like something like DOA or other three-letter acronyms that could refer to imprisonment, legal issues, drug impairments, all sorts of things like that. So I just want to make sure.
Let's just say that I spent more time in Denver yesterday than I really wanted to.
But it's a nice airport.
It is a very nice airport. Brand new.
Did you go to the Rocky Mountain Chocolate Factory while you were there?
I didn't. I hit. There's a cheesesteak place.
Oh, there are.
Yeah,
yes,
that,
yes,
there's a really good cheese place. Yeah,
I know. I know.
That was dinner last night.
I see. I gotcha. Okay. Anyway, boy, did we take a left turn? Hey, did we? Did we not? See, that's what happens when you got when you have a studio audience and
rodents.
You turn a mic on. When you have rodents in the office, that's where we you just move it. Okay.
Oh, that our Calvinist friends will have a million rebuttals to that. It's not about the rebuttals. It's not about really the what we're talking about right now. Could also.
Why isn't it what we're talking about right now? You know, why is it that William Lane Craig gets to just take these shots across the bow? But we're not going to debate that now. I don't want to do that now. It's not my calling. It's not my calling. My calling is take shots at you folks and warn everybody against Calvinism, but I'm not going to defend myself.
Also be, perhaps, Bill, someone who's very legalistic.
Yes, yes. Right, who has a very legalistic concept of God and so obeys God, toes the line, but doesn't really like God. I think that is correct as well, Kevin.
Now, he's not saying that that's what Calvinists are. I just want to make sure you understand that.
Is the God of Islam... Does he generate easily that kind of
I think for
reaction?
Many majority tradition Muslims, that's true in, for example, the Sunni tradition, where it's just a matter of law-keeping. Now, there are more mystical traditions in Islam, like Sufism, where there is more of a relationship with God that's emphasized. But I think you're right. For many Muslims, there would not be this sort of real love for God, nor would they affirm that God loves them in this sort of way that we're talking about here. I remember talking to one Muslim man who said it was just inconceivable to him that Allah could love us because we're like worse than ants to him. And you wouldn't love ants. You wouldn't love mere insects. So for him, the idea of God's loving us was just inconceivable.
Well, and at this point, I have to agree with Dr. Craig's insight at that point. The nature of the love that exists between the redeemed in Jesus Christ and any discussion of loving God in Islam is disrupted by the giant chasm known as incarnation. Incarnation. I guarantee you, any discussion I have ever had or ever will have with a Muslim on the subject of love of God will, of necessity, end up focusing upon the demonstration of God's love in the incarnation, which is the very thing that Islam says could never happen. Which is why Abdullah Kunda and I debated that issue in Sydney, and I'd like to see some more debates on that specific topic in the future, because it needs to be addressed, it needs to be understood, and the Muslim needs to understand that from our perspective, the greatest demonstration of the love of God is found in the incarnation of Jesus Christ and in his voluntary death. That's really where the gospel message, a fully biblical gospel message, has the greatest power in response to Islam itself, is right at that point.